Well, good morning. Welcome to the Baker Institute and welcome to our program this morning. I think you're going to find it a very interesting one. Education is very critical, really, to a nation's economic well-being, and it's very critical if you look at the world today and its technological base. Education is assuming even a greater importance. And we're very fortunate this morning to have seven individuals that have had a great background and experience in education, and they're going to speak to you about their approaches that they've used in their individual areas. We have four speakers that'll be here in the panel, and we have three speakers that are going to be speaking through a video and audio link. So I'll turn it over to our moderator, Neil Lane. Neil is a senior fellow here at the Baker Institute, a former provost here at Rice University, and also was President Clinton's science advisor, and was director of the National Science Foundation, and is a professor here in physics at Rice University. So let me turn it over to Neil.
Thank you very much, George, and ladies and gentlemen, welcome. It's very nice to see you all here and hear this distinguished panel on innovation and education. I think many people sort of think of U.S. education as kind of like the weather. I think Mark Twain was quoted, probably incorrectly, as saying, "Everybody talks about the weather, but nobody does anything about it." And I think you have a panel here who actually knows a lot about what you can do about education, and it requires innovation, and that's why innovation is in the title. So let me introduce everyone. I'm going to be brief. I'll refer you to the biographies in the program. I'll quickly go through the names and the affiliations of our panelists, and then including the three members of our panel who will be meeting us by video, audio-video connection. Then, with the panel's permission, I would like to start with one of our panelists, Sir James McDonald, who's in the UK with a 10-hour time difference, and so we'd like to start with him, and then we'll just go in the order of the program. I'll just let you hand off to one another, and I'll kind of stay out of the way. So here's our extraordinary panel. I mentioned Sir James McDonald. Dr. McDonald is Principal and Vice Chancellor of the University of Strathclyde. Dr. Heather Domian, who is Interim Executive Director of the STEM Center at the University of Houston. Dr. Bonnie Dunbar, Professor of Aerospace Engineering and Director of the Institute for Engineering Education and Innovation at Texas A&M University, our partner school just up the road. And then in addition to Dr. McDonald, by video, we have the Honorable Ruben Yanosa, who is U.S. Representative of the 15th Congressional District, and Dr. and President Diana Natalicio, who is President of the University of Texas at El Paso. We're honored to have with us the Honorable Rod Page, who's Interim President of Jackson State University and former U.S. Secretary of Education in the Bush administration. And then Dr. Richard Tapia, University Professor and Director of the Richard Tapia Center of Excellence and Equity at Rice University. Richard is a distinguished mathematician, I think many of you know. So with everybody's permission, let's start with Dr. James McDonald, coming to us by video from the University of Strathclyde. Dr. McDonald, are you there?
Yes, Neil, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Can everyone hear okay?
Yes.
Fire away.
That's great, Neil, and good morning, everyone. George, great to see you on the screen as well. Neil, I also smiled when you talked about the weather, because in Scotland, you probably know we have four seasons, and today we're experiencing all four seasons in one day, let me tell you. It was snowing earlier this morning, but enough of that. I was in Houston 2 weeks ago, and I look forward to being back with you in the sun quite soon. So Neil, just some broad comments from me. The timing of this meeting is very interesting for me. The Scottish Government has just completed its national consultation on the future of STEM education. We are a small nation, around 5.5 million people, quite a large landmass compared to that headcount. But many of you will know that we have a proud tradition of contributions to science, engineering and technology, with people like James Watt, John Logie Baird, who's an alumnus of my own institution. But we have had great concerns for the past decade or so, just seeing the dwindling numbers of high school people that are coming out and going into college and universities to pick up science and engineering activities. And that's a real issue. I have a confession to make. I'm an electrical engineer. I hold the Rolls-Royce Professorship in Electrical Power Systems, and I'm passionate about this. But there's a real hit, as George said, about the potential impacts on economy and the ability to create a society and indeed a workforce that's ready for the 21st century and the digital revolution that, not that we're anticipating, that but we're in the middle of. So I've given you some broad terms because there are a number of people who want to speak as well. So I'm not going to speak about MOOCs at this stage. I'm not going to speak about the digital means by which we may deliver educational materials, though that is fundamental. The young people we're bringing into universities these days are digital natives. They have expectations about the environment which we provide them for teaching, learning and engagement. And of course, the means by which we deliver this material is fundamental. I want to just give you some headlines which may stimulate some discussion, Neil. One of the key things that we've done is that we've taken a very hard look at what I would call what has gone on in Scotland and the UK over the past, I suspect, 20 years. I think we're suffering from initiative overload. In Scotland alone, we've counted about 1,000 initiatives to try and stimulate STEM enthusiasm and STEM participation from schools through college to universities. And that's great, but that speaks to me more about heat rather than light. And one of the key things we're going to try and do here in Scotland over the next 2 years is trying to get a degree of cohesion and cooperation between the various institutions that are delivering well-meaning and some of them rather effective programs, and trying to focus the public purse to make sure that we get the biggest, excuse the pun, bang for the buck, because I think teachers and schools are very confused because there's not a month goes by without they get another initiative on their desk to consider. So we have to take a national strategy. And that might be more straightforward for Scotland than it is for America, but of course you have the great state of Texas that you're sitting in that can maybe break it down into state-based approaches. So one little vignette I would say to you is that we've managed to bring business and industry into this discussion, and I think this is extremely important. We've created a set of industrial leadership groups, and as a result, over the past 18 months, we've created a number of national skills investment plans, and that's covered sectors including life sciences and chemical sciences, advanced engineering and technology, finance and business systems, engineering applications through into energy, and this has allowed us to connect potential business and industry investment in building the proposition for our young people in schools, in colleges and universities to key in to the opportunity that STEM brings them. But I would also say a key set of constituents in this is the parents of these young people that we're trying to influence and have them understand that their routes to employment, routes to fruitful careers, and the excitement of getting involved in physical sciences, life sciences and engineering. So through these skills investment plans, we're now pushing forward in terms of a cohesive approach to what we're doing. So I'll leave that one on the table, Neil, in terms of getting national plans around key sectors, getting industry and business involved. And another couple of things I would say, we need to teach the teachers. My own university produces the largest number of primary and secondary school teachers in Scotland on an annual basis. So we have a school of education, and we're now trying to make sure that we get as many physics, chemistry and maths teachers that we can produce as far as possible. We've noticed over the past decade the number of young people who want to become teachers are choosing humanities, social sciences, some business subjects, and fewer of them are picking up the what you might call the tougher but nonetheless the very rewarding subjects. So we need to think about that. The teachers in high school need to be comfortable with STEM, they need to be advocates for STEM, and if we give them some additional resource, including the support of business and industry, alongside the public sector investment, we'll get a better chance of getting a good outcome. And the last thing I'll say at this stage, Neil, not to overdo it at the front, is that programmes such as the ones that George Abbey and Bonnie Dunbar have been involved in here in Scotland, the Scottish Space School, have been truly inspirational, where we try to bring high-quality programmes to bear, getting out to our youngsters. In the main, the programmes that George and Bonnie have been involved in have been aiming at 16 to 17-year-olds, but we need to open that up now and get right down into the root of getting kids excited about maths, physics and chemistry. And we've still got the dilemma of young people up to about the age of 12 being really excited about the technology. But our experience in Scotland is there's something happens between age 12 and 15, which tends to hoover out a lot of real interest in digital technology and science and engineering. We need to think about that. So let me stop there with the key message I would give you at this stage. I think there are some real old chestnuts in this problem. There are many good solutions on there, but I think what's been missing over my career as an academic has been lack of cohesion, connectivity, collaboration, and quite frankly, continuous effort, because initiatives tend to have a 3 or 4 or 5 year lifetime. We need to be brave enough to take on board a generational approach to getting this done, and then working with our colleagues both in the public, private and sectors with academia in what I would call a triple helix approach to solving this problem. Private, public and academic groups working together to deliver something that the nation needs, and that's a highly qualified, excited bunch of STEM relevant graduates. Thanks, Neil.
Thank you very much, Dr. McDonald. And are you able to stay with us through the program for Q&A at the end, or would you prefer to take your questions now?
I owe George Abbey a lot as a buddy, so I'm going to stay in for at least an hour and a half, or George will never forgive me.
Well, let me, if the panel's permission, let me just see if there are one or two questions for Sir James, just in case he's not able to be with us right at the end of the program. Otherwise, I want to defer our questions for the other panelists, assuming everyone can do it. Yes, right here in the second row.
I have one. I've been running a program that Bonnie's familiar with and George is familiar with for over 30 years. It is a global program. We're very strong in Asia, Australia, the UK. It's a design competition for high school kids. We have a UK charity that is expanding. And I'm having a devil of a time trying to figure out how to expand it in the US. And I think Sir McDonald had a very good point about initiative overload. There are a lot of initiatives, but when we have one that's proven, we have a 90% positive answer to the question, based on this weekend, are you more likely to go into a STEM curriculum and career? How do we stand out and get funding and get a program into schools? We actually have our program in a high school in Durango, Colorado. It has school board approval to use our materials in that one high school. We can get it into every high school in the United States. We're just not able to break out above the crowd and show that we have a quality program.
So, Jim, could you hear that question?
Yeah, I think I got most of that, Neil.
So the issue here is the barriers that innovation really faces in our country, and it may be somewhat different in the UK, but here, in part because of the local, I think I could say, because of the local control of education at the K-12 level, even if one proves that a particular innovation is very effective, scaling it up, getting it accepted by the system with changes in principals and changes of superintendents and so forth, I think that tends to be our issue here. So maybe a question would be whether you have similar concerns, challenges in the UK.
Yeah, so it's a great question, and thanks to the colleague that posed that. So let me try and respond to that with a couple of case studies, Neil. And again, if I give you a general point, first of all, there's a natural temptation for us that there are lots of educators in this meeting today. And very often we'll find, if I call this the educational supply side, which is a very crude way of putting it, but let me use that term. You know, the educators, the universities, leadership, the colleges, the schools, we tend to be pretty ambitious and pretty well sighted on what the pedagogy is and what the methods will be to get young people involved in STEM. Back to what I said earlier, Neil, I think the demand side has to be lined up with this, because the supply side, i.e. the educators, all of the institutions that are represented in the meeting today, sometimes that we will say the things and elicit the response that, well, they will tell us that, won't they? One of the breakthroughs that I've experienced in recent years has been just getting that demand side, i.e. the voice of business and industry, alongside the supply side, as it were, to make a compelling case to government. Well, that's local government, and we do have a devolved system here in the UK, so we have a Scottish, and I'm sure you are cited on some of the constitutional dynamics that we are facing in this country as well these days, with Brexit and the potential for another independence referendum. The way that education is managed is England and Wales are run out of London, the Scottish education system is run out of Edinburgh, but there's a lot of collaboration across those boundaries. The key thing for me is the scaling up is a real issue. We've seen that in the space school. Our friends in NASA with George and Bonnie in their time having done great things for us, probably get to about 4,000 or 5,000 kids over a 2-week period, and about 150 kids get a special program. Now that's great, and it's very necessary that we've done that. But we need to try and get special experiences for every young person that's thinking about STEM. And another program, Neil, and I'm very happy to liaise with George to get some information that can be shared with the meeting today, is a program called Primary Engineer. And it's been sponsored by industry and sponsored by the number of the institutions, such as the Institute for Engineering and Technology, which is a bit like the IEEE. And it's getting to tens of thousands of kids between age 5 and 12 every year, getting local engineering groups, professional engineers, companies into local communities of junior schools and in some occasions high schools. And that scaling is one where we need a degree of collaboration. And again, I say respectfully, sometimes the public sector collaboration can be a bit fraught. But if we can get the demand side in there along with some investment, I've seen that breaking down barriers. And the other program I'll mention in the passing is a thing called the Power Academy, which was a direct response of the universities to a deficit, a demographic time bomb, if you will, in the utility industry in the UK about 15 years ago, where we seem to have a big hiatus between new graduates being recruited and the guys that were ending their career. So with 25 companies, including ABB, Siemens, Rolls-Royce, Alstom, a number of the utilities, we pulled together the demand side, and every year we're educating an additional 500 electrical engineers across the UK, involving Strathclyde University, Imperial College, Cambridge, Bath, and Queen's University Belfast. So scale means collaboration. Scale means cooperation, and scale means having a common vision of what we're trying to do at a national level.
Thank you very much, Jim. Appreciate the question and your response. I think we'll move on now, and our next speaker is Heather Domian.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So we're talking about innovation today, and of course, and I want you to think about the success of that innovation, because of yesterday's innovation actually was able to help propel the brilliance that we have of the inventions of today. And ultimately, the question is, how can we help to spur the passion within our K through 12 and there and beyond collegiate students to continue on the thread of wanting to be within a STEM field? All of us, I could presume, have a cell phone in our hands, is that correct? Absolutely. So think about, at this moment, how dependent we are on the technology basis. Did anyone get up this morning, Siri's tell you where you need to go, Google, by any means? All of those factors are our innovations. But yet, How did we get there, and how do we make sure that it sustains itself as we move forward? Well, we're talking about education today, and with education, I have the ability at the University of Houston STEM Center to work with K through 12 students in addition to those college students on campus. We have the ability to collaborate with the initiatives of helping students in STEM fields. We're finding with research that these students who are passionate at the end of high school and entering into their STEM fields, that there's a dropout rate. Their persistence is not what it should be at that point, and that they are not graduating as we would expect. So the question then, why? What is causing this to happen by any means? Well, I'd like for you to reflect for a moment on how you were taught. Were you taught in lecture style? Or were you taught with manipulatives, problem solvings, scenarios, as we call them in education, to be able to apply what you think and know to a position statement and to identify what that result would be? I work with educators, and in educating the students, we default as human nature as to exactly how we teach our students. If we were taught lecture-based, ultimately, no matter how much we throw at the students, particularly meaning to be able to learn how to teach interactively, they get in front of a class of students and they will resume back to what they were taught, lecture style. So we have some challenges by any means of what we're looking at in education. One of the main challenges that we're focused on here to be able to help spur the innovation of STEM is that of the curriculum, of which we have to be able to teach. So as it was mentioned, there's overload of policies, administrative constraints that teachers have to work with in a day in and day out capacity. And I will say, teaching to the test. How many of you are familiar with the STAR assessment? Okay. So having students, by all means, I am a proponent of assessments to know where we are, where we stand in our status, not to be static, but yet to be able to go back, reteach, and move forward. But when we get to the exemplar where we are having our teachers teach to a test in order to be able to get a certain score, how much does that delineate of information to our students? How much does that model to our students that we need the opportunities to think out of the box when in fact we're closed into it? What we're looking at here particularly in addition is we have our students who are innovators. Our entire community is based on the fact for us to have STEM education, science, technology, engineering, mathematics. But we have to, in my perspective, default to basics as well. The students that I currently see, do they know how to write an essay? Or do they text that essay? Which do you think would be the case? The basic being of what education started out to be has started to dwindle, and we have to make it of a more robust opportunity for students to understand what that expectation is of learning. Ironically, as we move forward, sometimes we step back, but we have to make that reflection. The rate that we're looking at for STEM jobs happens to be 4 times the rate of employment. At this moment, women are looking at 24% to be within the STEM workforce field. However, the capacity within the jobs that they hold are envisioning two different perceptions. Women are very strong in the ability to hold that position of STEM, but the challenge is family. The challenge is how can we support women in this force at the same time as family values, taking care of the students? That is one of those challenges that we work with. I want us to move forward here just for a moment. and take a look at this dynamic structure here. So employment in the United States and the largest STEM occupations, majority of those are from what type of industry? Computer industries. And of course, but does that make sense? Absolutely, it does make sense. So how do we then help to support students in kindergarten to be able to maintain the capacity to be that engineer and that computer programmer? How many of you have been able to be in a shopping center and see a three-year-old or less holding a cell phone, holding an iPad, working that iPad or notebook? We are growing up digital natives that are fearless with the unknown. We have to capture that and be able to infiltrate that within our teachers to be fearless as well, to be leaders, to model for instruction for students. So how do you do that? Professional development. It's support. Our past speaker talked about information overload. Programs, initiations within school districts. Why are they initiated in the first place? Because they see a deficit. But yet we're too much in a rush to be able to fill that deficit. So by the time things start to work in a school setting, change happens. So how can you propose buy-in from an educator if they know that in a year or 2 years, where usually a 3 to 5 year cycle of change should occur for a foundational program, is going to happen? They lose that spark of desire and passion to teach. They lose and do not want to be able to fully invest themselves to foster the students because they know things are going to move forward and change without them. And in many school districts that we work with as well as a STEM center, I see the factors where there are schools within themselves that have multiple changes within 1 year factor. So how can we move forward with that? Well, what we do is at the STEM center, we are up to the challenge to be able to help these students work and become invigorated with science. We work with professional development on different capacities with teachers during the week and or on weekends. We also work with students because students are our customers, correct? They are our future through different venues. And one of these venues that you see here is the Mars Rover event. So NASA has a mission. This mission is to be able to go to Mars in the 2030s. Have you heard that before? But how are we going to get there? What technology, what innovation are we going to use? Well, this event allows students to be able to be creative, invigorative by choosing their own particular investigation and presenting the information. And with Dr. Dunbar's help, as well as Dr. Barron, who started this program with NASA approval, it's 15 years into existence. Also, we have STEM camps. The sooner you can, as Richard says, the sooner you can get students on a college campus, expose them to STEM, how much more likely are they going to want to be in that STEM program? So that's what we work with here, is to be able to give them capabilities of engineering, electrical programming, as well as robotics, aerospace, manipulative, scenario-based challenges. I'd like to talk about another engineering and innovative factors here is at the STEM Center is we have the Science and Engineering Fair of Houston. I'm going to ask for a quick survey. Has anyone heard of that before? Okay, good. I feel better. This is the platform of engineering, science, STEM. Because with STEM, ultimately, students go to school. Why do they go to school? To get a job. And where are they going to get that job to support themselves in a STEM workforce field. This is a platform for a conduit for actually having conversations between STEM research that students, 7th through 12th grade individuals, have been able to work with over 500 plus judges and have the conversations of how they can move forward the industry. For example, we have had our last attendance of 920 students. Of those students, we had 56% female. That's 2% up from last year in that category. We have to work with our dynamics of demographics, because ultimately, teaching is for all. That's what America is about. In education, we work with students of all demographics, those who are underrepresented in all color and creed and beliefs. We bring them in. So how do you meet the students' needs successfully to ensure that all, ALL, is able to participate within STEM education? So our students here is an innovator by all means, and we had one of them, this is a regional fair, go to the state fair and then to the international fair. International fair, students compete for $4 million. Okay, and this is a global fair, over 1,700 students attend. And we had one of our students look at a scenario that occurred here within our area. Has anyone heard of the BP oil spill? That spurred his imagination to be able to create a subsea wellhead that encapsulated the oil leak and then diffused and filtered both the gas and liquid format. Is he an innovator? Absolutely. He was only 18. By the time he was 19, he became Forbes 30 under 30. Guess what? He is also now the student UN ambassador for the United States of America. Is this an innovator? Is this a model? This is what we want to be able to grow up. So it's for us as teachers to step out of the way, to be the facilitators of knowledge in students, and to allow them the ability to authentically learn teaching science as inquiry. If we don't teach through inquiry, through questioning, and instead lecture, and honestly, this is difficult for me because I'm usually in the audience, that's what teachers need to have, is because they need to be able to interact and make the learning meaningful of where we are. Quick notation. This is from Tim's report. And with this, looking at fourth grade and eighth grade and where we have been and where we are going now. So you see points on the board. The question is, did we increase or decrease overall? This is over 20 years of time frame. So for fourth grade, eighth grade, mathematics and science, the capability of what's needed, we have increased in all those categories. But is that good enough for us for over 20 years to be able to move the needle to ensure students' workforce? So we have challenges, ladies and gentlemen, in our education, and that is the fact of instructional time. Instructional time in education means that we have in K through 2, 80% for field investigations, hands-on thinking, minds-on thinking. 3 through 5, it starts to delineate from 60 to 50%. And where are we losing our students at this point? Middle school. After eighth grade, the ability and passion tapers off dramatically. And therefore, why? Because K through 12 is initiated with only 40% of instructional time to be hands-on field investigations. Is STEM lecture or is STEM hands-on, minds-on? How are we teaching our students? How are we teaching our teachers to teach those students? Is the question. That are those particular challenges that we face, but we must be able to ensure that we care. That's that four-letter word, care. In order to care, we have to plan. In order to plan, we have to act. So how do we act? It's involving all stakeholders involved, from that of school district, school board, to that of government agencies, from Texas Education Agency, who delineates that of instruction to that of allowing our students to have a capability to think for themselves. Innovation is a state of mind, by all means. We must strive and push through a stereotypical misconception. There are many misconceptions that are out there with students as well as with teachers. We have to change this dynamic course that we're on. And I call it dynamic because it has many functions within it. But if we don't step in the pathway and divert its course to where it should be going, our future is at stake. And that involves every single one of us. So make sure that as you look next time in the shopping center of that digital native working on their cell phone at the age of 3 years old, or changing your DVD capabilities, that they have the fortuitous ability to work in a STEM field. But I leave you with this. We have to start with the young in order to be able to move forward to ensure that STEM education is successful in the 20th century and beyond.
Thank you very much, Heather. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Bonnie Dunbar.
Well, thank you very much and good morning. Today I'm wearing a hat from Texas A&M University. I can't say I'm a native Aggie, but I'm working hard on my adoption papers. So I'm going to address that part of STEM that is often overlooked. In fact, the former president of the National Academy of Engineering, Dr. Vest, used to ask, has anyone remembered what E stood for? If I can get, there we go. What is an engineer? I'm an engineer. Theodore von Karman, who founded the Jet Propulsion Labs and was a well-known aerospace engineer and many other honors, defined it this way, and it's the way I define it to my students. Scientists discover the world that exists. Engineers create the world that never was. That's an important definition that we need to bring back to our K-12 world. We need to bring back into the conversation that we have in the general public, in newspapers, in the media. I can't tell you how many times I've had people introduce me not knowing what an engineer is and therefore default to scientist. I love scientists, and we do science as engineers. But engineering is a profession, and we have a challenge right now, not only in this nation, but in other nations, in Europe in particular, in educating enough engineers to create the world that we have. So just briefly, I'm going to cover a number of subjects this morning, and in the Q&A, if I didn't cover it in enough depth, you can ask her a question. Civilizations need engineers. That's how we innovate, create the world around us. There's a declining supply of engineers in the United States and Europe. What's the difference between inspiration versus push into STEM? K-12 for preparation was covered by Dr. Damian, but that is very important to us in terms of the pipeline in educating young engineers at the university level. And then I'm going to talk about what Texas A&M is doing in changing the conversation and the equation about engineering education. First of all, we need to remember that whether it was the pyramids or Mars exploration, that engineers and scientists created the modern world. And I talk about that in the broad sense. Mathematics, physics, chemistry, the application of all those to solving modern problems. As Dr. Damian pointed out, you know, we sit in this room with electricity and phones and electronic media. We get into transportation systems that never existed 100 years ago. And that innovation by engineers and scientists was built on foundations of what they learned back in primary school and before. I grew up on a farm, and my education started before I started formal education. You know, the biology around you, the climate around you, how plants grew, how animals grew, mathematics. A small farm is a business. Everything we do now is built on that initial foundation. when we ended World War II, and we had actually created a whole new generation of engineers and scientists through that effort, we embarked on a planned program of investment for the future, much of that driven by what was happening in space. And during that time, we saw a very rapid growth, not only in the number of engineers we were graduating at the bachelor level, but also the PhD and the master's level. And this actually takes us through about 1990. And you may be wondering what those two bumps were all about. Well, if I were to ask my classmates when I entered engineering in 1967 why they were there, almost to a person, they said, "We're going to the moon." It was space. I didn't know what an engineer was until I saw it on TV, and I watched Walter Cronkite and Jules Bergman. And maybe I didn't go to the moon or be part of the space effort, but I found something along the way that I really became interested in: medicine, geology, something along the way, astronomy, physics. But it brought them in. It was an inspirational factor. That power of inspiration was how I started. I didn't have parents that went to college. Many of my classmates didn't either, and I suspect some of you didn't, or most of you didn't either. There was something inspirational that happened. And my father, and inspiration is to me a powerful tool, because my father always used to say, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink, and we had real horses. So I knew that was true. And we see that in our students. We say, go into STEM careers. They don't know what STEM is. We made up that word about 15 years ago, right? It's science, it's technology, it's engineering, it's mathematics, it's solving real-world problems. And then we don't understand why they do, then when they get into the university, they don't stay there, because they don't have the passion, they don't have the tenacity, they don't have the end vision. You have to have a hook that gets you in to stay. It just doesn't happen through push. So my Apollo got me there, and the space shuttle kept me there, another inspirational factor. And in fact, that took me on my career, I'll go back here, working on the shuttle, and then eventually with NASA and being a flight crew member. And a little known fact that I pass on to students is that about half of all of the astronauts have engineering degrees. The other half have technical degrees. You want to be an astronaut or you want to work in those fields, you have to have a pathway to get there, and it doesn't happen overnight. My students think you should be the president of the CEO in 5 years. You all know that doesn't happen, but that's the expectations. So we had this great growth of engineers and scientists in this country, my generation, many of your generation, and we're retiring. Unfortunately, the pipeline is not keeping up with it. So if you look at this chart, which was produced by the National Science Foundation, that very steep curve rising to the top is the number of engineers being graduated by China. About 10 times the U.S. The U.S. has barely been cracking 100,000 for the last 30, 40 years. A line not shown on there, which is about 4 times the U.S. graduation rate in engineering, is from India. But you can see there are other countries that have been out, smaller countries, been outpacing the United States. And if you look at our undergraduate population, you'll find engineering's been very flat. All other majors are growing. So what's going on? Why aren't we inspiring it? We're even falling behind other countries in terms of our enrollments in science and engineering as a percentage of the population. So less than 5% of our undergraduates in this country are engineering majors. One can go to Asia and find 45% of the undergraduates on campuses are engineering majors. As a result, with this declining or flattening of the graduation rate, then the percentage of our young people in STEM careers, we call it, starts to fall behind. And now we're about 24th in the world in terms of the number of STEM graduates between 25 and 34. We're between Spain and Iceland, as a matter of fact. Now, this is not a new problem. It was first identified by the National Academy of Engineering in 2005. They wrote a seminal report. They presented it to Congress and the President. It was called Rising Above the Gathering Storm, Energizing and Employing America for a Brighter Economic Future. And it talked not only about preparation for engineering careers, but educating teachers and preparing teachers to teach math and physics. 5 years later, the needle had not moved. So the National Academy self-funded another report. rising above the gathering storm, revisited, rapidly approaching category 5. Now, I have to tell you, I was back in Seattle at the time, and I realized that most of my colleagues had no idea what a Cat 5 was. If you were in Houston, you knew what a Cat 5 was. And again, it talked about the depressed graduation rates. It talked about the impacts, not only in industry, but the impacts on national defense. It talked about K-12 preparation, and it talked about the preparation of teachers. We are not moving the needle much. Dr. Damian said we've been moving it some, but not a lot. And if we are very introspective here about Houston, and we look at the 2009 PISA math scores, not by nation and not by state, because nation, we were 50%. We said, gee, we're average. We did it by state, and if you looked at Texas, it said, oh, we're average. Massachusetts was at the high end. There were states in the southeast at the low end. But they were divided by city, and when they did that, Houston was in the lower quartile in math scores. That's your foundation. If you're in business, mathematics is a language. I don't care if you're the cashier counting out change, or you're at the high end of the CFO, or you're an award-winning, Nobel award-winning physicist. Mathematics is the language of the modern society for sustainability. Harvard then did a study where they, again, looked at all of these cities. And they made the statement, this was called U.S. Math Performance in a Global Perspective, and compared us to other nations. San Diego, Houston, Washington, D.C., Chicago, Los Angeles, and Atlanta are all clustered below Uruguay and Bulgaria, but above Chile, Thailand, Romania, Brazil, and Mexico, placing them at a level roughly equal to that of a Latin American country. Now, we know school districts in the Houston area that are performing in an outstanding manner, and they send their students to the Science and Engineering Fair, but we also know school districts that are not preparing their students, not providing them with high expectations and the rigor of a good education. But it's not just the teachers that we need to be thinking about. We need to be thinking about how are we inspiring our students. I'll just give you an example now. You might ask, why isn't the International Space Station inspiring students? We just had a press conference between the president and Dr. Peggy Whitson, who set the U.S. record, not the women's record, but the U.S. record for time in space. It was a long press conference. They talked about the science. They had Dr. Kate Rubin there, who did DNA sequencing on the International Space Station. And I'd be willing to bet most students in the Houston area didn't know. Because I spoke to a middle school 2 years ago out by the Intercontinental Airport. 700 students in a middle school. I gave my presentation about space. I saw a lot of blank looks. And I said, how many of you knew that there was a space station in Earth orbit? And I had 5 hands. The teacher later came up to me and said, we don't teach about that topic because we don't have a telescope. Now, most of you... Well, that didn't surprise me. I once had an adult ask me if the station orbited the moon. So, you know, what happened? When I was growing up and it was on TV every day, I at least knew we were the third planet from the sun. Half my undergraduate engineering students don't know that. I do clicker quizzes with them. So we have a challenge. It's a challenge of recruiting into engineering, but also the persistence and retention. And that was mentioned by Dr. Damian. And when we look at the root causes, we find out even if we've got the inspiration, we've got the passion, they're not always well prepared. The 4.0 math student took multiple choice tests. They never actually solved a real problem where they had to figure out where all the variables were. I once had a student in a test tell me, there's too many variables here, which equation do I use? I said, you know, you're 2 years from employment, never ask your boss that question. We have students coming in that barely had physics. It said on their transcript they had physics, but they really hadn't worked physical problems. They're just unprepared sometimes. High schools that don't make them do homework. They haven't learned to take notes. They haven't learned how to write. I have some students that are surprised to find out that engineers actually have to write. They have to communicate. They have to talk to their boss. They have a reduction in real world experiences. 50 years ago, we could work on things and take them apart. You could order parts from Sears for your washing machine, you know, things like that. Nowadays, students work with their thumbs a lot, and it has decreased their ability to connect the classes to the real world. That's why experiential real world education is so important. And the other is dated stereotypes, and I have to bring this up. Industry is crying for engineers. Industry doesn't care what gender you are, although there is a favoritism right now for young women. They want all ethnicities. They pay well. The cultural and the institutional environments are wonderful. They care. Teachers don't know that. So I had actually had a high school guidance counselor tell me that she did not advise engineering to her students because her students like to work with people. Or a young woman who told me that she did a Google search, and the Google search turned up all these negative articles, and that's how they were valuing or evaluating a career in engineering. So let's get done with the negative narratives and just look at who's out there. Look at Dr. Whitson. Look at the women who are in engineering. So the solutions at Texas A&M, first of all, believe in both the combination of formal and informal education. We are working out with K through 12. In fact, we'll be partnering with the Lone Star Flight Museum in some of their offerings out there where they use flight to reinforce mathematics, algebra, geometry, trigonometry, and pre-calculus. Part of that inspiration factor, why do I need to know that? We're also helping to change that conversation with false narratives about engineering and engineers. What do engineers do? Well, engineers create the modern world. There's a lot of different majors, and you can solve many of the world's problems by applying the physics, the chemistry, and the mathematics to them. We're also building a brand new building at Texas A&M called the Engineering Education Complex. It'll be the largest such building in the United States, devoted to hands-on exercises and experiments for freshmen. So instead of waiting till their senior year for the design project, we've already got them working on 3D imaging and complex equipment and designing. We hope to increase recruitment and retention. It's going to be an enriched environment, and we're going to bring in more practicing engineers. We want to help retain and inspire the next generation, and so we're preparing for them at the Texas A&M University. You may have seen that 25 by 25. We hope to have 25,000 engineers on campus by 2025. We're at 18,000 right now, and we firmly believe that you must become the change you want to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bonnie. So next is the Honorable Ruben Hinojosa. Congressman, are you on?
I am on. Can you hear me?
Thank you, sir. Yes, we can hear you. So, and we can see you. So thank you for joining us.
Good morning to everyone. I want to congratulate each and every one of the panelists for participating at this wonderful event. It gives me a tremendous sense of pride to be a part of this spectacular learning experience, to join such distinguished leaders in higher education. I have enjoyed listening to the previous three speakers, all from different universities. You will have an opportunity to hear from the point of view of a congressman who served on the Education Committee for the last 20 years and several years as the chairman. So thank you for inviting me. After 20 years of serving as a United States Congressman, I didn't run for re-election. And so for the first time, I did not report to Washington, D.C. at the start of the 115th legislative session, January 2017. Serving as a U.S. representative was such an important part of my life, as well as for my wife and for my family. As I closed that public service chapter, the time I served in the federal government, I discovered that there was one part that I could not walk away from. And that very important part is education. One of the achievements we are particularly proud of is having improved in South Texas the high school graduation rate. It was with the help of Region 1 Education Service Center that it located in Edward, Texas, which serves the southernmost part of Texas along the Texas-Mexico border, that we have ably and consistently leveraged collaborative efforts and funding to benefit the K-12 students we serve. The high school four-year graduation rate in Region 1 has improved from 65% in 1984 to 88% for the class of 2015 versus the state average of Texas, 89%. A shining example of this regional collaboration is Region 1 Gear Up Partnership. Now, in its third act, the federally funded Gear Up Partnership in South Texas has served over 30,000 students, their families, and communities from across the region, providing them with vital information about college access and affordability, as well as the necessary academic skills to succeed in higher education. This partnership brings together 30 school districts, 6 higher education colleges and universities, over 40 banking institutions, business and industry, as well as nonprofits and major media outlets to reach and serve our area with high need constituency. As such, a collateral benefit of this education program is that Gear Up mentality, that accessibility to higher education as a reality for everyone, has permeated our community as a whole. I am proud to be recognized as one of the 2 congressional authors of the Gear Up legislation, which was passed by Congress and signed into law by President Bill Clinton in 1998. Congressman Chaka Fattah from Pennsylvania and I provided constant support for this innovative program that I wish to share with you. Because of its proven success, it's one of the premier college awareness programs in the Rio Grande Valley of South Texas, and is the 2nd largest Gear Up program in the nation behind Chicago Public Schools. The Gear Up Springboard has allowed us as a region to support or create a valley-wide prescribed course of action for student success, such as the following. Created the South Texas Literacy Coalition, which provides thousands of free books from Reading as Fundamental organization to high need families yearly. Created the Deep South Texas Financial Literacy Alliance, which teaches students sound core financial strategies addressing credit cards, savings accounts, and college student loans. The Education Service Center focuses their resources to train teachers to teach advanced placement courses and international baccalaureate courses. This large-scale partnership with Gear Up supported my long-held passion for STEM and ME education. It has always been my belief that STEM and ME, which stands for science, technology, engineering, math, medical, and energy professions, is where our students will find good-paying careers that will help them improve their quality of life. You may have heard of HESTEC. That acronym stands for Hispanics in Engineering, Science, and Technology. The area that I represent is approximately 90% Hispanic. It is a hallmark initiative hosted yearly for 1 week on the college campus of what is now the University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley, located in Edinburgh and Brownsville, Texas. In 2016, UTRGV celebrated the 15th anniversary of HESTEC. is recognized as a bright spot in Hispanic education by the White House Initiative on Educational Excellence for Hispanics. HESTEC is a nationally acclaimed program for promoting science, technology, engineering, mathematics, medical, and energy professions, with Gear Up students as an initial core audience. This HESTEC program rapidly expanded in 15 years to serve over 8,000 educators, over 58,000 middle and high school students, over 22,000 college students, and 45 national corporate sponsors and partners, as Boeing International, as Dell Computers, as well as Lockheed Martin, as well as Texas Instruments and the H-E-B grocery chain. All of these huge audiences have participated in HESTEC over the years, with approximately 1 million people in 15 years having been touched and inspired by this initiative. HESTEC gives families the message, it doesn't matter where you came from, who your parents are, your economic background. If these areas of study fascinate you, there is a career for you, if you are willing to put in the work for it. Lastly, I bring to you a new recruiting booklet that I hold up for you to see. This booklet was just published 2 days ago. It's brand new. And I can tell you that this recruiting booklet, which will ignite the curiosity of young minds in our country, starting in the third and fourth grade, as was said by some of our previous speakers. It was collaboratively designed by Region 1 Education Service Center, together with higher education entities, with premier regional school districts, and local businesses and industry that represent a new approach to learning that will reap the similar benefits of STEM as I have known it for these last 15 years. We call it STEM and Me, Science, Technology, Engineering, Mathematics, Medical, and Energy, because those last two careers, those last two professions, is where we have lots of jobs to offer. Yes, engineering is very important to us. I can tell you that we've had great success. We've already graduated over 2,000 engineers at the Rio Grande Valley UT campus of Edinburgh, with 34% female. But look at what ACA has done, Affordable Care Act. It has created great demand for healthcare. And look at energy. Look at the oil and gas industry, as well as the renewable energy that is available. That's why the Department of Energy created another booklet just last year entitled Girls of Energy. I hold it up because this is as exciting as STEM and Me booklet, which I think will give the listeners opportunity to see how we are approaching the recruitment of boys and girls of all ethnic groups. You'll notice in the booklets that we have pictures of African American, of Hispanic students, of Asian American students, because education is for all. And these opportunities in STEM and Me can be a great teaching experience for them from elementary school through middle school, all the way through high school, and then that they can get into the university of their choice. Careers in these fields will open up countless opportunities for students, but we can't sit idly by and watch it evolve. No, we need to get out ahead of the game and be early adopters. Much like many of the initiatives that have started here in South Texas, we intend to lead the way, not just for South Texas, but for the rest of the state and the nation. Finally, on innovations of education, our South Texas region is home to 44 early college high schools, the biggest concentration of ECHS programs in Texas. Among these many best high schools, I wish to recognize the and talk about the nationally recognized South Texas ISD's magnet high school system, similar to the one in Houston and Dallas. We have six campuses, and I'll mention three. First one is South Texas High School for Health Professions. The second one is Science Academy of South Texas. The third is BETA High School, which stands for Business Education and Technology Academy. The superintendent is the outstanding Dr. Marla Guerra. And I can tell you that for the last 20 years, they've been listed by Newsweek as the high schools that lead the best high schools in the nation, the top 100 best high schools in the country. Also among these best high schools in Texas, please take a look at PSJA ISD. That's the Far San Juan Alamo Independent School District, led by Superintendent Dr. Daniel King. He has received many awards of excellence from Secretary of Education Arne Duncan and from President Barack Obama, recognizing his wall-to-wall early college high schools. At schools like these, students earn high school and free college credits concurrently, which is a boon for students with limited financial means. These particular school districts have leveraged partnerships with UTRGV, with Texas A&M University, South Texas College, with the Region 1 Education Service Center, with two of our biggest medical centers. One is Doctors Hospital at Renaissance in Edinburgh, and the other is Valley Baptist Hospital in Harlingen, Texas, to provide students with a course of study leading to an associate degree in nursing at the same time that they graduate from high school. This is unbelievable. This innovative initiative was built specifically to address the severe shortage of nurses in our state of Texas and represents the very best forward thinking and collaboration. And it is the first effort of its kind in the whole nation. This accredited framework by the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board has now been modified and expanded to three additional college-ready high schools in our region. In closing, ladies and gentlemen, I invite you to visit the following three websites that will be shown to you there at Houston, at Rice. It'll be posted on your screen to view and download our three booklets, STEM and Me, Girls of Energy, published by the U.S. Department of Energy. And the third one is the booklet entitled Goals in Education by the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board, spearheaded by Dr. Raymond Paredes. Please remember this. Very, very short message. Our job is just getting started. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Thank you very much, Congressman Hinojosa, and congratulations on such an extraordinary career of public service in the Congress, and we're all of the many contributions that you have made to the country and to education in the country. We are all in your debt and delighted with that you're continuing to focus on such an important issue as education. It's an honor to have you with us today. We do thank you very much. We hope you can stay for the Q&A session at the end. We'll make sure that the materials are talked about, the information about them is made available to everyone here. Thank you again.
The answer is yes. I will stay for the question and answers. I think that I need an hour to be able to share with you what has happened in Deep South Texas these last 20 years and how it has been transformed into an area that is the fourth fastest, largest growing region in the whole country. When my colleagues in Congress asked me what's going on down there with so much construction and growth in population, and growth in the universities and the community colleges, I tell them we've invested in education. but we are being very smart in creating booklets like these, which will help the parents of the students in elementary school, and then middle school, and then high school, so that they can see where the great opportunities are for good paying jobs and good paying careers as professionals, and that is working for us. When you teach mothers about these opportunities, they will see to it that the kids get the homework done, that they go to school, and that they finish high school, and that they enroll in the colleges of their choice.
Thank you so much, Congressman. So our next speaker was to be, I'm sorry to say, not able to join us, Dr. Diana Natalicio, president of UTEP. The link between here and there, somewhere along the line, has been dropped. And so we're very sorry that we're not able to have Diana here. I had the great pleasure of working with her when she was on the National Science Board, a very productive member of that board, and when I was director. So we're certainly disappointed, and we certainly hope to have Diana on a future occasion, what she's done at UTEP in her record-long tenure there is just quite extraordinary. So let me move on to the Honorable Rod Page. Dr. Page, please.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
My thoughts today emanated from an article I was reading for the New York Times, January 16, 2015. Title of the article was "Percentage of Poor Students in Public Schools Rises." I'll read the first paragraph. Just over half of all students attending public schools in the United States now are eligible for free or reduced price lunches. Eligibility for free or reduced price lunches is a proxy for poverty. Another way to state that is over half of the students in the United States public schools are from poverty environments. So if we want to draw from the total population of students, that segment of the population must be addressed. And so I have some thoughts about that. They may deviate somewhat from thinking about how do we graduate more STEM students, but I invite you to think that we're going to have to begin at another level with this segment of our population. I began by reading some comments that a professor at Texas Southern University wrote some years ago when I was dean of the College of Education there. Going through some of my old notes, I ran across this. Almost 15 years have passed since the current generation of school reform efforts was ushered in by an alarmist publication called A Nation at Risk. Even so, Americans view their public school performance as disastrous. In spite of 15 years following A Nation at Risk, brimming with well-intended school reform efforts, an alarming high and growing segment of America's population, especially minorities who populate our largest cities, is still at risk due to major education shortcomings. Although years following the release of A Nation at Risk were replete with gargantuan efforts by skilled and well-meaning education theorists and practitioners, student underperformance, especially in science fields, still goes unabated. Notwithstanding billions of dollars of local, state, and national educational investment, the National Assessment of Adult Literacy reports that 32 million Americans are functionally illiterate. Although dropout programs abound, at least half of the students who enroll in our big city school districts leave before they finish 12th grade. Disastrous performance of American youth from the most recent International Mathematics and Science Study amplifies this assertion. Well, rereading that prompted me to give some thoughts around this particular issue and this segment of the population that's dragging the performance of our nation's children down. And so I'm going to provide some thoughts about that. And I used an email that came from a member of an organization that I hold membership in, going to its founder, and it goes like this. Over a billions of words float through the education literature, education press, education blogosphere. If you search all those billions of words that flow through all the education space, you'd be hard pressed to find the term substrate. S-U-B-S-T-R-A-T-E. Nonetheless, substrate is a term physician Eric Chang Tung, a practicing Plano, Texas thoracic surgeon, this is a term he used when he emailed a letter to Jim Windham, president of an organization designed to help reform schools in Texas. He used this term in his email. Being a member of the board, we all had a copy of the email. This is some of the words on this email. While successful education delivery is the goal, I personally believe that the substrate, in parentheses, individual student, is more of a problem than the delivery platform, in parentheses, teacher. Now, we were discussing teacher quality. And Dr. Tung is commenting on the last meeting where he sat through the whole meeting without making any comment, listening, went home and sent back this email. Because we had spent the whole day discussing teacher quality. And he's saying that he thinks that the substrate, in parentheses student, is more of a problem than the delivery platform, in parentheses teacher. He goes on to say, I believe that a successful education requires both controlling the teaching platform, but also addressing the student's substrate. He further writes, there needs to be as much effort spent on the student substrate and environment as on the teaching platform. This is the missing element of our school reform. When I sat through all the meeting, read the email, I had no earthly idea what substrate meant. So I went to the dictionary. What does this mean? As such, for definition, this is what I found. Substrate is a surface or material on or from which an organism lives, grows, or obtains its nourishment. It is the base on which an organism lives. In case of plants, it's the soil. The soil is a substrate of most seed plants. The earthly material in which the organization lives, or the surface or medium which the organization grows, is attached. So if you look at the term substrate from a biological point of view, it's easy to conclude that the earthly material in which an organization lives, or the surface or medium on which the organization grows, or is attached, or the surface or material from which the organization grows, lives, and obtains its nourishment, you can find some relevance to our education reform efforts. For instance, it's widely understood that the quality of plant growth grown in one's garden is significantly impacted by the quality of the garden soil, the plant substrate, so to speak. A gardener knows full well that the plant grown in a poor soil environment, where there's inadequate moisture, a deficiency of proper nutrients, and poorly cultivated soil will not achieve the quality you seek. No matter how carefully you deal with the plant, ignoring the substrate will fail your operation. It's for this reason gardeners not only nurture the plant through providing proper pruning, proper spacing, removal of weeds, air protection from insects and other pests, but also goes to great length to improve the soil in which the plant lives, grows, and obtains its nourishment. So the gardener tends to the plant soil, its substrate, so to speak, to provide improper irritation, adding fertilizer, proper tilling of the soil. In other words, to achieve a healthy plant, the gardener cares both for the plant and for the plant substrate. Dr. Chang Tung appears to be suggesting that as quality plants grown requires that type of attention, so does education. Dr. Chang Tung is not the first to express this insistent point. As far back as 1994, Lawrence Steinberg shouted this message to us through his compelling book, Beyond the Classroom, Why School Reform Has Failed and What Parents Should Need to Know. His feeling about this issue is powerful. It is by no means easygoing. He closed his book with this statement: no curricular overhaul, no instructional innovation, no change in school organizational structure, no toughening of standards, no rethinking of teacher training or compensation will succeed if students do not come to school interested in and committed to learning. In order to understand how this commitment develops, why it has waned over the last three decades, and more importantly, how we can encourage students in the business of learning, we need to look not only what goes on in the classroom, but at students' life outside the classroom. And until we do this, school reform will continue to be a disappointment, and all of our student achievement will continue to fail. Lawrence Steinberg and Dr. Chang Tung are not alone in this belief. The education literature is brimming with research and expert opinions supporting the concept that a student's home and community environment plays a major part in the academic achievement of the student. It's not difficult to find research which confirms this idea that children who have a home environment where parents exhibit quality parenting skills constantly express and exhibit the importance of education to their children. Check the child's homework, attend school meeting, have ready contact with the student's teachers and administrators, attend school events, demonstrate trust in the child, and have a regular discussion with their children about social programs, school programs, activities, and classes. And have these type of children have an enhanced possibility of success at school. Moreover, some researchers go even further. They're so convinced that the impact of a child's home and school environment has on the academic success that they see it as the primary influence on a child's goals, motivation, learning, even more importantly, the school factors. Now, when you take a point of view like this, what happens usually in the audience, what goes through their mind is this: what do we have to do with schools to a child's home environment? That's not our issue. We are going to teach the child when they come to school. Well, our issue here is, I think, the changes in our social environment, social and economic environment, especially for that half that we just talked about who are eligible for free and reduced lunches. Obviously, we can't mandate any change there, but we can provide opportunities for parents to learn about parenting, proper parenting. And also, we can change this idea of good parenting and good cooperation with schools, where many school systems invite parents to come and help with school programs, raise dollars, you know, participate in activities in schools, and things like that. That's important, but it's insufficient. What has to happen is the parents' encouraging of the school's attitude when the child is at home, helping the child understand what kind of behavior will bring success in school, checking the child's homework, helping with homework, talking about the importance of education, and those types of parenting activities, as opposed to coming to school and baking cakes and cookies. Well, the argument can continue. Our teachers have enough to do. They have no time for all of that. Given that's true. But there are some places in history that we can find, in Operation Evil now, that we can find where this concept is being looked at very carefully. I invite you to take a look at Miami-Dade public school system. They have a program called Parent University. In this Parent University, they invite parents to the Miami-Dade school system to learn parenting skills. Now, obviously, you can't mandate that parents come, but that resource is available for parents who choose to come. And you'd be surprised how many parents would and do choose to come. There's a similar program in the Baltimore County public schools. So I'm talking about there are issues that we can attend to, things that we can do that can provide parents who want to learn more about proper parenting that can be helpful. So if you think the idea that that children are going to spend about 15 to 16% of their time in school, we're going to give away all the other time that they live in our learning, in our teaching and learning for our education. That's where we're losing the battle. So it may be just possible that this unintended issue needs a little bit more attention. We should pay more attention to it. It may possibly be that we're having some difficult time comparing with our Asian and European neighbors, not only because, or not so much because, what goes on in the school, but it may be that our children have a stronger substrate than our children do. Let's get that fixed. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, President Page. So our final speaker on the agenda is a good colleague, Dr. Richard Tapia. Richard.
It's a pleasure to be your final speaker. Whoops, there goes my talk. Okay. So I have an image that I have to maintain, okay? I'm often direct, controversial, say things people don't like, but are true. Okay. When I was on National Science Board in 1996, the director of the National Science Foundation, our friend Neil Lane, called me in and said, "Richard, you make my life difficult." And I said, "Neil, that's good, okay?" The administration at Rice University, our current, they've called me in. "You make our life difficult." Good. By saying truth. Now, I've been given a platform, and I have to use it. I'm the first Hispanic elected to the National Academy, the only Hispanic to win the National Medal of Science, the only Hispanic to win the Vannevar Bush Award. So I get a lot of opportunities invited to speak out on issues. So I have to use that platform. I'm in an engineering school, Bonnie, but I'm a mathematician, okay? Which it makes, I'm a piece of both. Now, what I have two things that I would like to share with you. First of all, there's the Richard Tapia Center for Excellence and Equity at Rice, and we have a web page. We have a magazine. See, I have six copies there. If anybody wants one, they can have it. They're free, okay? See, great. And what we're trying to do is this summer, we're trying to have, they're called Tapia Summer Camps, 1 week camps, two in computer science, two in mathematics, two in physics, and one called the 1-2-3 for valedictorian, salutatorian, or number three in the class, okay? And we're trying to get 4,000 students. I have recruiters out right now. In fact, I want to mention to Representative Ruben Hinojosa, one of my recruiters is in South Texas, and I'm going to call him after this meeting and ask him to try to talk to him, okay, about this stuff. All right, so the two immediate things. So on the back of this magazine is a thing called Tapia Talks. And I write about things that are bothering me, that really mean something to me, and yet, you know, contemporary issues. So the first one I'm going to talk to you is gender equity is stepping on the toes of underrepresentation. So it's on the website, so you can look at it, but let me read a bit, okay? So I say gender equity is stepping on the toes of minority representation. We all have some interaction with women, and most of us appreciate their plight. But we cannot say the same thing concerning underrepresented minorities. Indeed, many associate attempts to improve minority representation with negativity. For example, a lowering of standards and unfair hiring or promotion practices. This negativity and resentment is reflected in the recent mass white support of Donald Trump. Women tend to be educated in parallel worlds with men, while minorities in general tend to be less well-educated than white women. Hence, the gender equity problem is much easier to solve. So in the past 60 years or so, we have seen excellent progress in improving gender equity as compared to improving representation. Indeed, look at today's movement of women onto the science and engineering faculties of research universities, into the national academies, into the top-level administrative positions of major universities, as compared to essentially the complete lack of similar movement for underrepresented minorities. As a consequence, this is important, women are able to promote gender equity from a position of power and authority. Unfortunately, this is not the case with minorities. In raising dollars for a recent Richard Tapia Celebration of Diversity in Computing conferences, there are two conferences in my name, I was told by a giant technology company on the West Coast that upper level administration had many committed champions for improving gender equity, but none for improving representation. So they would contribute to the Grace Hopper conference that promotes gender equity in computing and not to the Richard Tapia conference. The female population of the country has a natural upper bound of essentially 50% or so. However, the minority population has only 100% as its upper bound. Well, with the browning of America, the nation's health will be seriously compromised if an ever-increasing part of the citizens are completely left out of the backbone strength that made America great: science, engineering, technology, computing. Gender equity is a moral and ethical issue, as is underrepresentation. But the latter carries with it a component that it progressively more greatly endangers the scientific health of the nation. Okay? So that's from the back page of my magazine. And I've written several articles recently and given talks about gender equity stepping on the toes of underrepresentation for obvious reasons. Okay, so, my second point. We've had some excellent talks about how we need to promote things at the bottom. So my talk here is going to be, there exists much room at the top. There is room at the top. We, the underrepresented minorities, are here. Just look at the demographies, okay? Look at the statistics on how we're growing fast, and there's going to be many of us, and the nation is being flooded. We're here, but we're not there. We're not in positions of authority. We're not in the positions of high faculty. It's STEM research schools, okay? I'm a mathematician, proudly so. I'm a Chicano, proudly so. I'm not quite a Tejano because I was born in California, but that's okay, okay. Math department faculty representation, hard facts. University of Texas, Austin. How many black and how many domestic-born Hispanics on the faculty in the math department at UT Austin? No black, one brown. A&M. No black, one brown. Rice Math Department, no black, no browns. Rice Applied Math, one black, one brown. But University of Houston, which prides itself in diversity, Math Department, U of H, zero black, zero brown. I tried to talk to the president, didn't want to talk to me. Tried to talk to the provost, didn't want to talk to me. And I had a candidate that was one of our PhD students that was perfect. And we had discussions and interviews. But instead, they hired another one of our Rice students who happened to come from Russia, who was very good too. But he wouldn't offer those components that were needed for mentorship and being a role model. So they hired the one, but not the other. Okay? University of California. Ah! Entire University of California put together. How many blacks in the math department faculty? I'm talking about domestic born. Zero. How many Hispanic? One. Okay. So is Texas worse off than California? Not really. Okay. Now, what's the cause of all of this? We've heard comments. Poor preparation in K through 16. By the time they get to graduate school, it's too late. Poor preparation in K-16. Lack of basic knowledge. Not the motivation. The students that I get at Rice, they're motivated. But the basic knowledge is what's hurting them, okay? And they don't know that they're underprepared. They don't know it, and neither do their teachers, okay? A couple stories. I taught a class in optimization last semester. It's called CAM 560, and Sid Vera sends all his students there. I had 34 students. 24 were Chinese from China. Okay, 34 minus 24 is 10. 10 were from the United States. Okay, if I ordered grades, the top 34 were Chinese. Top 34 grades. Doom, 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 doom. Then came in domestic students. No minorities. Zero. Okay, they were very well prepared. I loved the students, all of them. The Chinese were really prepared. They ran fast. Okay. Last week, I gave two talks at the National Math Festival in Washington, D.C. We saw hundreds, thousands of 10-year-olds, 9-year-olds, 8-year-olds with their parents holding their hands. Let's go see this math talk. Let's go see this math talk. It was a beautiful thing. Those parents weren't black. They weren't Hispanic. They were Indian and Chinese. Beautiful. These kids were so precocious, they sit in the front row and ask questions of world-class scientists, Indian and Chinese. Where were the Browns? The parents, the blacks, okay? So you cannot catch up in graduate school. And that's what we think we can do, okay? Consequences of sending our best underrepresented minorities, but underprepared, to schools that are, that they're not prepared for, let's say it that way, okay? Selective schools, okay? Like Rice, okay? Consequences, one, they drop out from school. Two, they migrate to the other side, and we end up with a world full of sociologists, okay? Okay. Number one major for minorities, sociology. Do we need another world full of sociologists? Okay. Well, we need some, I think. Okay. Okay. So they may stick it out and graduate, but they get beat up so hard they're not prepared for graduate school, and they don't want to go to graduate school. Okay. So what happens is we lose these underrepresented minorities from STEM forever. And we tend to say, here's a danger. I was underprepared when I went to UCLA. Sending underprepared students to highly selective schools, okay, takes them out of the picture. I often ask, had I gone to Rice as an undergraduate, would I have a graduate degree? I went to UCLA, okay? So we have to worry about that part of the picture. Now, we must lead ourselves. When I was on the National Science Board, I argued, we understand ourselves, we know who we are, we know who we are. Why do I work? All my life I just wanted to be a mathematician. But I started doing research because I've been there. I know what it's like. I can help, so I have to. We can lead ourselves, so we should be put in positions to lead ourselves, okay? So, my daughter had a quinceanera years back. And I went to Ping and David Lebron's daughter's bat mitzvah. And I go to a bat mitzvah, and it's beautiful and everything. She's now prepared to be a lawyer. And then I go to the quinceañera, beautiful. She's now prepared to get married, okay? And I contrast that, and I contrast that. That's it, thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Well, let the record show that I was not critical of Richard on the National Science Board. Some of the best things that get done make your life difficult. So thank you very much, Richard. So we're ready for some questions, and I'll start right here on the third row. Thank you. Please speak up as best you can, because I'm not quite sure about the acoustics.
In South Korea, the STEM graduate among university graduates is 32%. That's twice the rate of the United States. In South Korea, which is a country of less than 30 million people, you have 148,000 graduate in engineering a year. The United States, which is 10 times bigger, doesn't have even double that amount of engineers graduating each year. Mm-hmm. So one has to look not on Chinese or Indian immigrants in the United States, why they are doing so well, but in a country that has nothing to do with immigration, what they are doing that is right. Now, coming from another educational system in another country to this country and comparing to what I see in the education here, I notice two differences. One, vocational schools are considered something for not that bright students. That's not true in other countries. There are countries where partly vocational schools are very good schools, and for students that want to continue to do things with their hands, mechanical, electronic, and other, they have an opportunity without blocking their way to the universities later. And if you ask me where the school will find time for doing this, there is another observation that I made. They emphasize in sport, in the school system in the United States, is above anything that I've seen in that country. And I'm from Israel.
All over the world, you mean.
Thank you. So I'll ask panelists, whoever would like to speak to this very real issue, which I think we all recognize. Yeah. Bonnie, you want to make a comment?
Yes, I would. So when I was in Seattle at the Museum of Flight, and we were expanding our educational STEM K-12 offering, and I was visiting with all of the suppliers to the Boeing company, one of the observations they made is they hire a lot of high school students, but they were having to actually train them in what they thought were the fundamentals. And when you're working with a digitally run 3D milling machine, you have to know algebra, geometry, and they found many of their students didn't even know those fundamentals. So there is a definite interest, and I agree with you. I was the first in my family to go to college, and my parents are extremely bright. And my brothers were. They all did vocational type of things that we need to ensure we have a good foundation in K-12 that includes math and science, just to live in this world and go into the vocational trades, and then put a re-emphasis on things like bringing shop back into high schools. You know, that's even for the engineering students not knowing, you know, I was doing clicker quizzes on what's the difference between a straight edge and a Phillips screwdriver for my freshmen, which was sad. But, you know, I agree with you that on the vocational side of it, and then making sure that graduating from high school, they have the basic skill level. I won't comment on sport. I'll get in trouble in the state of Texas. So, yeah.
Dr. Page.
I'd like to comment just a bit. For example, I think it has a lot to do with the exposure that kids have early on. I'll give you an example of that. A couple of years ago, Bonnie, a really low-income school in Houston had a chance to take its fifth and sixth grade students to the museum in Galveston. We have a museum in Galveston with old airplanes. These kids had never seen airplanes on the ground like that. So these were troubled kids who were having real difficult time in classes. But we had to literally drag them out of that museum. Because being able to see these airplanes on the ground and crawl around on them made a tremendous impression on them. They had not had that kind of impression before. And I inquired about how those kids were doing later on, a couple years later, and it had a deep influence on them. By the way, they've been clamoring to go back to the museum. So I think we need to expose kids earlier on these type of activities that emanate from around STEM activities.
Richard.
Your point is well taken, of course. I mean, it's culture. It's the culture of a nation and the way we're brought up. I mean, I was brought up, you know, loving cars and sports, and I happened to be good at math, okay? But I didn't know that at first, okay? In my class this year at Rice, the number one student, I asked him, where are you from? And he said, China. I said, where'd you go to high school? He said, Singapore. Singapore recruited the high school students from China to Singapore to go to high school. I asked the number two, where'd you go to high school? South Korea. He was also from China, was recruited to South Korea just to go to high school. And they were way ahead of the game. See, so it's a cultural thing. The talk that I gave last Saturday, it's called Math at Top Speed. And it's about, because my twin brother and I set world records in drag racing. So it's how do you use mathematics to understand issues like drag racing? And it pulls in kids, the teachers say, they've never asked questions like that before. Yeah, culture.
Neil, may I make a comment?
Where are you?
I'm in Glasgow.
Oh, you got my back. Yes, please do. Please do.
Just tell George I've been staying awake for the past 2 hours. So, Neil, just a quick comment. Our colleague with the reference to the vocational training, just for interest, in the 1st of April this year, the UK government passed a new tax, which is called the Apprenticeship Levy, which is going to be, in fact, it's active now, it's 0.5% of turnover for enterprises that have more than 1,000 employees. So it applies to me also as president of a university with a $600 million turnover. And this is to create a national investment fund to create something like an additional 200,000 apprenticeships in the United Kingdom, in direct response to what our colleague talked about, that, you know, maybe 20 years ago when we started to talk about a knowledge-based economy in the UK, we focused everything on university graduates. Now, it's easy to see where some of that lazy thinking would come from, but the truth is that we need that spectrum of high-quality technical skills all the way through to PhDs, and I think the point that our colleague in the audience made is a good one. The key thing is to make sure that we maintain pathways between colleges. We call colleges and school the place where they go after 16 for vocational training, and when they get to 18, to make sure they've got pathways for those that wish to pursue it into degree education. But it's taken direct government intervention to replace the valuation of vocational training in this country, because the tendency over the past two decades is to downplay it, which means that the school leavers have seen apprenticeships and their families have seen apprenticeships as second-class education. And the truth of the matter is we need to see this continuum, and where it's appropriate, direct taxation seems to be stimulating that in this country.
Thank you very much, Jim. Next question.
For the past 5 years, I've lived and worked in India. I ran the research department at Reliance Industries in Mumbai. And in India, the values for education, the best students go into engineering. If you can't make it into engineering, you go into science. I thought that's kind of an unusual twist.
No medicine?
No. I mean, those were the number two, one and two. Now. I hired a lot of PhDs, and most of the PhDs we hired, we wanted to hire Indians, okay? But the Indians we had preference for were those that did their PhDs and postdocs in the US and Europe. The best PhD programs are not in India and not in China. They're here. So I always thought it was kind of unusual, and I'd like to hear comments. You know, how can we be doing so badly in STEM at the lower levels, but yet we seem to have the best science and engineering schools. The second question, I read a book years ago by Dr. David Schaefer, University of Wisconsin, How Computer Games Help Children Learn. Okay? And it's about experiential programs, so children can experience what it's like to be an engineer or a doctor or whatever. And when young people ask me, why did I become an engineer? I say, because it was fun. And I think if we can find ways to show kids that these things are fun, that'll motivate them. Now, taking them to events and museums is good, but a limited number of opportunities to do that, where I think if you had computer games, like Dr. Schaefer talks about, you might be able to expose more kids to why this is fun. So I'd like comments on those two things. Thank you.
Thank you. So, panelists?
Well, I have a comment about on engineering and graduate school, because we've had some discussions about this. You know, our nation has always benefited from the influx of scientists and engineers from around the world. I mean, it's what we are as a country. But at the PhD level, particularly in engineering, it appears to have become a little unbalanced for a couple of reasons. Depending on which source you read, but I think the last one I saw from National Academy was that about 60% of our engineering PhD students are 50 to 60 foreign national, and they call them FN, okay, and it would be great if we could keep them here. We don't, because most of those are coming from China and India, and they have an interest in bringing those students back, in fact, financial incentives to have them go back home and start companies. Yeah, start companies there, and I've talked to some of these students. It's quite lucrative to go back and either start a company or join a faculty. They also come self-funded. So what I see as a trend is that it's becoming harder to bring in domestic students because there's not as much funding for research at the federal level. You have to work a little hard at the business level to get PhD research funding, or even at the master's level. So they have an advantage. They come over self-funded. They have incentive to go back. And now it's becoming increasingly difficult to find faculty. I was recruited past retirement age, basically, as were some of my other peers, by the way, to come in and both teach and set up research programs. And that's something we need to be thinking about on that pipeline. We are going to need continual input of faculty, experienced research faculty who can relate to our students. And so that means we need to think about the funding pipeline in engineering, you know, not the social sciences, or some of the other sciences, but in mechanical, ocean, aero, electrical, all of those, civil, because those are underpinning our national companies as well, that research. I'm hopeful that we can see that again, the Apollo level funding. Many PhDs I know that are my age say they got, and I did too, got through on NASA grants and with faculty. So that's an observation. I think we're going to have to take a closer look at that, and also, by the way, pay a higher stipend for a graduate student. So there's such a demand for engineering bachelor degrees right now that it's usually double the salary of a PhD student. So,
let me just add a comment about your first question. I think undoubtedly the rise of the American universities, research universities in particular, due to World War II. Huge infusion of money from the federal government into those universities for the first time in history. Prior to that, universities had very little interest in federal funding except in agriculture. So huge amount of money funded, and then a decision made by President Truman actually to continue that practice of the federal government making major investments in universities with the thought that that was going to be good for peacetime, and of course the Cold War was heating up at the same time. The Apollo program was a big part of that, but it was happening in all different areas of science and engineering, many agencies. One lesson for that, I think, is yes, that's where we are now or have been recently, but we can't assume that in the next couple of decades that universities in countries like China won't rise to be comparable because we're not now increasing our investment in U.S. universities. It's going down, has been going down for a very long time. Total R&D in this country as a function of time has been cratering. And we were number two 20 years ago. The total public-private investment in R&D I'm talking about. We're number two maybe 20 years ago. We're now 10th or 9th in the world. Big part of that is government investment. So we've lost our will to continue that leadership position in higher education and in science and engineering. It's not been there in the political circles because I think it's maybe not there in the general public. But World War II started it for us. Meanwhile, of course, many parts of the world were trying to recover from decades of war. And so we started with the time advantage of not having gone through that devastation on our own soil, having lost, of course, huge numbers of lives in the wars, but not having destroyed our whole infrastructure. So we got a head start, and we continued to make that investment. Those days are over. So we really do need to pay attention to your number one question. Richard.
Yeah, so what I want to say, yeah, we've been the envy of the scientific world in graduate education, and we should be. I mean, we have excellent graduate education. Okay. Now, our faculty care. So I work, I tell you, man, I have these seven summer camps for high school kids. I don't have problem getting Rice faculty to help me. Okay. I do have problems getting young faculty to help me because I worry about their tenure case. I saw when I grew up a long time ago, you know, as a minority, universities used to hire to fire, okay? And in many good universities that you would be surprised were investigated because they hired to fire. They hire minorities and then nobody gave them, they counted the hires but not the fires. So I got tenure. I had to get tenure fast, and I did. And then I said, okay, now I can start to help. So I do that with our faculty too, to get tenure. But the evaluation process for these young people, not only does it not take into account this, say that they're doing some kind of outreach with the K-12 world, but it's also not an easy vehicle to see how they can get involved. So I could have somebody come to me and say, I want to get involved. I want to help the country. I don't know what to do. How do I do it? What it is, okay? And so, you know, they can't spend time trying to just find out all the things that are available. They need some direction. So we need for the faculty to care some easier way to learn how they can get involved to help the K-12 world. That's what we need. But they do care. When I have volunteers on my minority programs, I never fall short of faculty who volunteer to help or to mentor. Okay, they care. But they need a vehicle that will get them there quick and easy and not spin their wheels too long.
So, well, let's have another question. Yeah,
I have the microphone mic here.
Oh, great.
Right okay. Here.
Microphone. Thank
yes.
you.
Well, I'd like to go back to Dr. Rod Page's remarks because I think they're absolutely important. And from the standpoint, first of all, I'd like to thank you all for being here. This has been quite insightful, that we do have to address the socioeconomic status of society and how you're going to change that, you know, the level of poverty in society. And I think, again, as China has been brought up as an example on many occasions, you know, we can also look at the chart that Dr. Dunbar showed of the Chinese students rising up in the level of engineers and STEM programs. How has this come about? A national mission from the government, from their nation, which has been a commitment and a national mission to rising over 700, 800 million people out of poverty. And this has been as a result over the past 20, 30 years. And until you address that question of how it has been under President John F. Kennedy and Franklin Roosevelt in the United States that we had a commitment nationally to raise young people and the nation as a whole out of poverty, a national mission through our space program with the Apollo mission, that's what we need right now. And as you look at the example, what China's doing with the call for many nations around the world to join with the One Belt, One Road project, the United States should be actually joining with this as the rest of the nations, because economic development is the key to why these young people would want to be a part of these types of STEM programs. So I'd like for you to address that more. How do we actually organize for a unified national mission in this country once again?
Thank you. So any of our panelists wish to comment on that? Sounds like a softball for you, Dr. Page.
I'm not sure I can answer that directly, but I can make an observation that I think is critical in the nature and developing science and technology in our countries. It has to do with the availability of teachers in the public school systems that are equipped to take on that task. I don't remember the exact numbers now, but I can tell you that I was astonished to read an article one day that showed that the graduates from the teaching certificates in Texas last year, many of them were in elementary education. We need great elementary education teaching, of course. Many were in sociology. But the number in math and science was really minuscule. There were very few. And I think the solution to that has to do with the compensation structure that we have. We need to pay attention to the fact that we got tons of sociology certified teachers, tons of elementary certified teachers, very few math certified teachers, but the salary for math teachers and sociology teachers is the same thing in a public school system. So that situation, I think, is really what's founding on reducing the number of people who are really going into those subjects.
Bonnie.
And it's a good observation, because the only reason I'm sitting in front of you is that I benefited from a kind of an Eisenhower, Kennedy, Vannevar Bush program called the National Defense Education Act, which, when I was coming through high school, if you had the grades and the SAT scores and you were going to major in science and engineering, provided you a combination of a grant and a loan. You probably heard of the National Defense Education Act loan. But it also funded students who were going to go to the education college to teach those subjects. And they didn't have to pay back the loan, I'm told. So as long as I majored in engineering. The other qualification I had is that we use free and reduced lunch now, but my parents were actually homesteaders, and I was classified as needy in the school system because of my dad's our farm income. And because I had the grades, it wasn't a handout, it was a help. I had the grades and the SAT scores. I qualified, and the income, I qualified for this National Defense Education Act, which I think had a 5-year range. There were thousands and thousands of students like me that became engineers during the Apollo and Shuttle program because of this financial funding. And we went into what we called middle-income careers. We paid back our loans, and it was a tremendous impact on the country. I think there have been reports on it. That's a small step, but that certainly would be an important step, is to really look at that investment cost and what it'll do back. Because then once you have students inspired that don't have any other means to go to college, but this is what they want to do, and they're academically qualified, then there's an opportunity to invest in them, and they'll return that investment to the country.
Thank you. So let's take one more question where the mic is, wherever the mic is.
Is it on?
Yeah.
Am I on? There we go.
How many do we have?
I got a very specific comment on one of the questions.
Let's start back here, and then I'll come up here. Thank you.
My question, it's great broad perspective on all the efforts that are being made, but one thing I wanted to ask was, once we open all the doors to access the education, it still takes a tremendous amount of hard work on the part of the individual to make it through. There's setbacks, they need mentorship, they need motivation. I think our culture sort of denigrates geeks. It's not particularly for perhaps some, each can speak for their own culture, or perhaps women. My daughter, I had some experiences, she was accepted as a engineering student, but she sort of got, there's some math problems that we never did solve. And there's kind of the cultural thing of instant gratification. Science, technology, engineering, and math are not instant gratification topics. You have to stick with it for a long time. And I guess that's my basic question. How do we address this problem for the perseverance that it takes to get through to the STEM or these other programs? And thank you.
So Heather and then Richard.
Sure. Well, I think that's a very valid question. It needs to establish itself in kindergarten. By all means, we have natural curiosity individuals, and we have to be able to ensure that those students are exposed to problem-solving investigations, but yet more so, it also involves top-down. Will the teachers have the capability to have the freedom to teach, yet not being tied to a curriculum standard that is so specific, that is correlated to a test question? I think once we are able to release some of the constructs of teaching, because before the 2000s, of course, in 1990s, teachers had that capability. Once we have standards, by all means, standards are good. I'm not negating that, but yet we have to allow the autonomy of teachers to know their classroom and their learners within the classroom and what those needs need to be met, and have the ability to function within those problem sets. The standards in science do not permit for a lot of thinking outside of the box. And why do I say that? It's because it is tied to specific concepts. The engineering concepts are maybe infused, but yet if teachers do not know how to infuse or what those concepts are for engineering and capacities and structures and strategies, then we are a deficit at what we're seeing right now. And so it lines itself vertically as that conduit from K through 12. And it progressively compounds, because we're in elementary, you're gonna have a better opportunity for students to possibly be taught science, but in all sense, science is hardly taught. But why? Math is taught, reading is taught, but science is not tested and accountable for it. And neither is social studies as well.
Richard. Yeah,
as I visit schools, I visit a lot of schools, okay? I tell them, I don't want to know your acceptance rate. I want to know your retention rate, okay? Don't tell me about how many you accept. I want to know what you retain, to put a percentage of that. And almost every school that retains a lot has support programs. So I say, don't accept if you don't have a support program. Now, I produced more women and minorities in the mathematical sciences than anybody in the United States, and that's why I win a lot of these awards. But we have excellent support programs. Every one of my minority students and others, if they want, has a faculty mentor, not a student mentor, a faculty mentor. And I have no shortage of faculty volunteering, and they have to meet once a month, and I follow up. So we have very good. Then we have a community, and we get together. And so you don't feel isolated, and you don't feel alone. And the thing is, and it works. So support programs. I mean, Uri Treisman at University of Texas with the Emerging Scholars Program is legendary with a support program in elementary calculus for, you know, he doesn't target minorities and say, oh, you know, it's just this, but it's a support program and they do very, very well. Well, that's what we have. We undergraduate program at Rice is called Empowering Leadership Alliance, and the graduate one is called ARGIA, Rice Graduate Education for Minorities. That's what I do without those support programs. And you don't force people into it. You have to be subtle. Do you need, can we help you in this kind of thing? But anyway, that's what happens across the country. Those schools that are successful have some method for supporting the students and bringing them together, and those don't, just say, sink or swim. We used to be a sink or swim, but we're not.
Thank you. One more question.
Yeah, I have a comment and a question that is so related to all these things that have been talked about. I'm the founding CEO of The Learning Company. And one of our early products was called Rocky's Boots, which taught the basic of computer programming. AND gates, OR gates, if-then gates were all connected together on screen to make little machines. And it was a wonderful, fun game. However, the early childhood education people would push their students towards Reader Rabbit and Writer Rabbit, which were, quote unquote, the necessary skills, and away from a program like Rocky's Boots that made programming fun. So my comment is, it's frustrating, and how can we change that?
It has to take a paradigm shift in mental capacity and thinking of it. Parents, support group. If we can reach the parents in your perspective and to show the validity and the value within that program setting, parents will get on board. And many times it has to take the community to be able to make education shift its course and direction as to why they are doing what they're doing.
Other comments?
Absolutely, teachers. However, teachers are at times even more set in and have more control because they have the administrators that they're trying to work with as well. So parents don't have that thumb that's on them to be able to make those comments.
The teacher spend their time preparing doing paperwork, prepare file for lawyers in case of lawsuit. and the parents dictate to the teacher what to do.
Thank you. We're out of time. I think we're over time, in fact. So I would like to ask those of you who still have questions to bring them down. I want to thank Congressman Hinojosa for joining us for this lengthy but very interesting and insightful panel. Thank you, Congressman. Thank you, everyone else.
Thank you.